Good. Good for now. Thank you.
I want to welcome you back to the second day of our conference, and we're going to have three superb panels today and an excellent luncheon speaker as well. This promises to be just as great a day, if not better, than yesterday. I do want to remind you that in your packet there is an evaluation form that we really do encourage you to fill out as they go along. To catch any errors that I can fix for next year's conference. And speaking of errors, there is an error that I caused on this evaluation form that I want to bring to your attention. We omitted to have Deborah Prostein's name on panel. My thought was that you would automatically give Deborah an E for excellent across the board, so I didn't even worry about putting her. No, that's not true. Anyway, what we need to do is on yesterday's panel, would you please just pencil in, or with a pen, put Deborah Prostein's name in. And that is my error, and I apologize for it. But obviously, we want you to give your comments about Deborah. And Bill's name is on there twice, so he can get two excellents. Other than that, I do encourage you to fill out that evaluation form. As I told you yesterday, I look at every single one of those to try to make our comments better. Another reminder, again, each of the three panels today will have reserved at least 15 minutes at the end for comments and questions from you. And we've got, Bev and Ryan Caldwell this morning who will be working the microphones for you. If you have a comment or a question when the moderator opens it up, please just raise your hand so either Ryan or Bev can get you the microphone. And again, please identify yourself because we are recording these proceedings. They will be posted on the Duke website for researchers and others to look at the entire proceeding from start yesterday until finish today. The entire conference proceedings will be available on the internet. So we want to make sure that when you ask that very articulate question, that those watching will know who asked the question. We have our first panel this morning, which is terrorism and the use of force. And so without further ado, Noah, let me turn it over to you.
Thanks so much, Scott, for inviting me to participate and to assemble this panel's dream team. I'm very curious to hear what you have to say on a number of issues pertaining to the use of force, national security, and terrorism. How it's going to work today is that we're each going to speak for approximately 10 minutes, except me. I'm just going to direct the order of events, after which I'm going to ask some questions to the panelists in order to get the discussion moving. And then I'm going to open the floor, and we're going to spend the remainder of the time bouncing around some of the ideas that are going to be raised at today's panel, including drone strikes, targeted assassinations more generally, legal challenges related to the changing pattern of global attacks, and the crime of aggression. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the first panelist for today, and I'll be introducing them right before they speak, one at a time. So the first panelist is Michael Glennon to my left, professor of international law at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, Tufts University. He holds a BA in the College of St. Thomas, a JD in the University of Minnesota. Before going into teaching, Mike was legal counsel for the Senate Foreign Relations Committee during the chairmanship of Senator Frank Church in the 1970s, which pertains to the topic he'll be speaking about, targeted assassinations. Professor Glennon has testified before the International Court of Justice and numerous congressional committees. The blank prose Crime of Aggression, his recent article on the crime of aggression recently came out in the Yale Journal of International Law, and a related International Herald Tribune op-ed came out on the 5th of April on the same subject. Professor Glennon's new book, will be up this month. It's titled Fog of Law, Pragmatism, Security, and International Law. His topic today will be targeted killings.
Noah, thank you very much. Scott, thank you for inviting me to participate in this wonderful symposium. As Noah mentioned, I just want to say a few quick words about the issue of targeted killings in international law. And then if we have time, we can address domestic legal questions, perhaps afterwards, any questions along with issues concerning the crime of aggression. I just want to make a few very brief points concerning targeted killings in international law. First, there is no simple one-size-fits-all answer that resolves all contentious cases. There is no, in my mind, clear, overarching analytic framework or algorithm that can resolve all contentious cases. The answer is plural, by not in neat categories, but rather on a spectrum. At one end of the spectrum lies clear lawfulness, as epitomized by the killing of Admiral Yamamoto during World War II. At the other end of the spectrum lies clear unlawfulness, as epitomized by the efforts to assassinate Fidel Castro in the 1960s. Now, second, between those two poles lie cases that are intensely fact-dependent. My friend Alan Morrison jokes that good law schools should be called not law schools, but fact schools, suggesting the importance of facts in cases such as this. And indeed, in no area of the law are fact situations more important than in this realm of international humanitarian / jus ad bellum. In some of those cases, under traditional classic legal analysis, factors such as the following might be relevant: the nationality of the target, whether a state of war or armed conflict exists, where the killing occurs, whether the government of that state consents, who orders the killing, whether capture rather than killing might be possible, whether efforts at capture would be futile or too dangerous, the likely consequences if the individual were not killed, whether the nation of the target has engaged in a violation of the laws of war, whether that violation is likely to continue, the degree of involvement of the target in that violation, whether treachery or deception was involved in the killing, whether it was carried out by uniformed members of the state's armed forces, the reliability of the intelligence that identified the target, and, of course, the extent of likely collateral damage. Now, I've just noted 15 different variables that are all potentially relevant. Assume that there exist binary answers, yes, no answers, for each of those variables. 15 factorial indicates that there are 1,307,674,368,000 possible permutations of those facts. Third, it should not be surprising, therefore, if the law did not address every one of those potential fact situations. In some cases, there may be no law. In those cases, under international law, international laws, default rule would apply, namely the freedom principle. In such cases, the rule would therefore be that the acting state would be free to act, since no state can meet the burden of establishing an applicable restriction. Now, I want to devote the remainder of my remarks to talking about one side of the spectrum, the pole of clear unlawfulness. I want to suggest to you a hypothesis. And the hypothesis is that targeted killings in circumstances such as the Castro cases, the Castro case, are unlawful for reasons that are far more fundamental than the reasons that are commonly given. Such killings are, in fact, I suggest, unlawful for reasons so fundamental that they don't even fall within either of the two traditional sources recognized by international law's doctrine of sources, customary international law and treaty law. Let me take treaty law first. Some contend that targeted killing violates the United Nations Charter. My suggestion is that this argument at once claims too much and also too little. It claims too much in that it relies upon, it implies that killing a terrorist anywhere in the world at any time is unlawful if it can plausibly be labeled self-defense. And it claims too little in that it relies upon a treaty regime, the United Nations Charter, that has been hollowed out over the years by repeated violation. I suggest to you that targeted killings in circumstances such as those surrounding the Castro assassination efforts were unlawful long before the United Nations Charter was framed in 1945. Long before war was outlawed in 1928, and indeed long before the emergence of jus ad bellum. I suggest to you that it was unlawful because the exercise of police functions and law enforcement activities within the territory of a sovereign state without the consent of the government of that state is incompatible with the very notion of sovereignty. Core meaning of sovereignty has to do with the exclusive right to exercise what we now refer to as enforcement jurisdiction within a state's own territory. It is impossible to imagine how the state system could exist if any state could kill or kidnap anybody in any other state at any time. Now, history, I would suggest to you, seems to bear out my hypothesis. Before the 17th century, there was no norm against assassination. Hundreds of assassination plots have been recorded involving the Italian city-states, Spain, England, Holland, and the rest of Europe. Leading thinkers such as Thomas Aquinas and Thomas More approved of assassination. But in 1648, as we all know, the world changed. The Treaty of Westphalia was signed. The new basic organizing principle set out in the treaty was non-interference, non-intervention in the internal affairs of other states. And just about that time, a sea change occurred in thinking about assassination. Gentili, Grotius, and Vattel all condemned it. And it's been condemned ever since. Thomas Jefferson condemned it. The American Labor Code condemned it in 1863, as did British Foreign Secretary Charles Fox in 1806, Britain's Oxford Manual in 1880, the 1899, and 1907 Hague Conventions. And the practice of targeted killing largely came to a halt. So this restraint existed long before, as I say, long before the emergence of jus ad bellum, long before war was outlawed in 1928. To this day, for all the highly publicized exceptions, state-sponsored killings and kidnappings continue to be a fairly rare phenomenon. Prohibition has targeted killing of the sort attempted in Cuba in the 1960s, therefore comes from something far more basic than the United Nations Charter. It derives from the core notion of sovereignty laid out in the Treaty of Westphalia in 1648, which is embodied in modern times in limits on the exercise of enforcement jurisdiction. Now, why does this rule work? The high level of state compliance with these limits illuminates something important about the relationship between international rules and state interests. Rules that don't work, paper rules, run counter to state's interests. Rules that do work, on the other hand, embody state's interests. One major reason that states honor the prohibition against assassination is that it is consistent with their interest, namely their fear of retaliation. This was one of the prime motivations behind President Ford's executive order in the 1970s banning assassination, now embodied in Executive Order 12333. States have a direct, concrete interest in this rule's vitality, because quite simply they do not want their own territories to become a shooting gallery. Effective security regimes are driven by a pragmatic reciprocity of advantage. So for this reason, the classic analytic framework of the second principle source recognized by the doctrine of sources and customary international law is, it seems to me, inadequate in explaining the continuing vitality of the prohibition. A rule of customary international law requires not only practice and opinio iuris, it also requires a causal relationship between the two. It requires that the practice be followed because of a sense of legal obligation. Now, I suppose it's possible that an abstract sense of obligation might be a marginal motivation in this context, but the primary impetus of states that forego assassination, even though they are possessed of motive and capacity, is probably, as I say, fear of retaliation. The effect, if not the very object, of their forbearance, therefore, is to preserve the sovereign barriers of the Westphalian order, which existed long before the United Nations Charter was a twinkle in anybody's eye. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. That gives me some food for thought for the questions. Our next speaker will be William Banks, Board of Advisors, Distinguished Professor of Law at Syracuse University College of Law. Bill is also the Professor of Public Administration at the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs. Bill's a BA from the University of Nebraska, an MS and a JD from the University of Denver. Bill Banks has served as the Special Counsel to the United States Judiciary Committee. He is co-author of National Security Law, the leading text in the field, now in its fourth edition. In 2003, Bill Banks founded the Institute for National Security and Terrorism at Syracuse. One of his new articles pertains to the subject he'll be speaking about today. It's called Legal Sanctuaries and Predator Strikes in the War on Terror. Bill's new forthcoming book is called New Battlefields, Old Laws, Critical Debates from the Hague Conventions to Asymmetric Warfare, and it's an edited collection. Today's topic, the drone strikes.
Thanks, Noah. Excuse me, I'm going to walk over and get my joystick. That's all right. Bring it up here. That was a joke. This is a clicker. The joystick shoots at targets with a drone. I'd like to thank Scott Zillman and Noah Weisbord as well. This is always a highlight of my year to come to things that might be useful. Many of you know this area, you know these machines, and you're familiar perhaps even with the technology and the targeting issues. Some of you are not, and I'll just go over a few questions more than answers in the introductory time here today, and certainly Michael's context is so helpful. In fact, I would have been here a couple of days earlier than I was, but I was busy counting those permutations of different issues. It's a lot of counting. The top one of these is predator drone. The bottom one is the Reaper, which is a more recent version of the same. And I think some of you know far better than I do the differences. Certainly, the technology continues to change. Capability for long-time hovering, the video surveillance that can be conducted from these UAVs is far more sophisticated than it was even a few years ago. They're up to 24-hour hover time now, great distances with tremendous quality of resolution on a video image. So that's what we're dealing with. And I do have, in addition, videos for now because it takes a couple of minutes, and maybe it's best just to say to you, you probably knew this, go to YouTube, hit Predator Strikes, and there are hundreds of these things up there. You want to see how things work. I'm not trying to be macabre, but it's simply an illustration. But let's go beyond. One of the ones that's most well known, I thought we'd get to the hard case, is Pakistan. This guy, Masood, was the head of Pakistan Taliban, who was killed in one of these strikes last August. This one was quite celebrated in many places, but the circumstances are set out pretty much there. This guy had been a thorn in the side of the Pakistanis for years. He's head of the Pakistan Taliban, and among other things, he probably masterminded the assassination of former Prime Minister Bhutto. He was also, however, implicated in attacks on United States targets inside Afghanistan. So here we go, the cross-border raid and sanctuary back in Pakistan. On the 5th of August, two Hellfire missiles from one of the drones piloted by someone from the CIA at headquarters in Langley hit his father-in-law's house in South Waziristan. Now, Masood was lying on the roof of the house at the time, where his wife was with him and an uncle, who was at the time administering an intravenous drip for Masood's diabetes or his kidney condition. The missiles killed everyone on and in the house. Was it a hard-won victory, or was it assassination or murder? A few issues about Masood that are illustrated by those bullets. Was he a combatant in an armed conflict? Was he part of an organized group that was fighting against the United States? If so, of course, he could be attacked at any time, receiving medical attention or otherwise. He was not a member of such a group. Was he a civilian that was nonetheless taking an active or direct part in hostilities? In Pakistan, it's conceivable that there are maybe Taliban groups that are fighting, that are not joining in the fighting in Afghanistan, and are thus not legitimate targets in that armed conflict. Is there an armed conflict in Pakistan? And if there's not, is there a legal basis nonetheless for targeting Masood? If we get to the Obama administration, as you know, drone strikes have increased in their frequency and apparent popularity in this administration in the last 15 months or so. The president said we cannot tolerate a safe haven for terrorists whose location is known and whose intentions to act are clear. location within a sovereign state will not shield them. Michael made some important points in international law that we should discuss further in a little while. Location within a sovereign state will not shield them, according to the president, and intentions for them to act against the United States are sufficient for the U.S. to strike. According to a news story in the New York Times on April 4th, the bombardment in North and South Waziristan by drones picked up in frequency, fast and furious, was a quote used in the Times story. Since a combined Taliban and Al-Qaeda suicide attack on a CIA base in Khost, Afghanistan in late December, in the first few weeks of 2010, more than a dozen strikes killed up to 90 people suspected of being militants. Some days there were multiple strikes on the same day. Clearly the drones have become a preferred weapon or a weapon of choice for the Obama administration after the president declined, after the Pakistanis declined to mount their own military offensive, the ground offensive in North Waziristan, to take on the militants who used that area to strike at the United States in Afghanistan. Facts are elusive, as the last bullet point says. As you know, if you're around in the media here, you can see numbers that widely are different one from the other. Some say that up to 50 civilians die for every terrorist that's killed. Others say that 10 terrorists are killed for every civilian casualty. U.S. military and intelligence sources have indeed credited the strikes with a seriously detrimental effect on Al-Qaeda's capacity to mount major military operations. The improved drone capabilities allow lingering longer about a potential target to better assure identification. One or two more points here about the legal bases. Of course, the president's statements are policy, not law, and the president's statement that we could strike terrorists in their hiding places was not a statement limited to conditions of war or conditions of armed conflict. Contemplates, I think, by his statements, the use of force in some situations that may not meet the criteria for either. Many of you know that the legal advisor to the State Department, Harold Coe, made an important speech at the American Society of International Law a couple of weeks ago in Washington. And you see some points made by Mr. Coe in his speech there. He offered a really vigorous defense of the use of force against terrorists. You see some of the central quotes of his remarks there. The speech, of course, is widely available online, and the section on the use of force is only about a page long, but there's a lot of content there. At least there are some very important bullet points. The operations, he does say, are conducted consistent with the principle of distinction. Must be limited to military objectives and conducted where no civilian targets are deliberately chosen. In addition, consistent with the principle of proportionality, civilian losses may not be in excess in relation to concrete and direct military advantage necessitated. The law in this setting really has three different facets. Maybe I'll make a couple of points here about the rhetoric that's associated with these strikes now, and then stop and come back to the three spheres of law in just a minute. For many, the increased use of drones by President Obama and his administration represents a major asymmetrical advantage owned by the United States in the war against terrorists. You follow the state of counterterrorism and use of force in recent years, and you noted the topic of the book that Noah mentioned that I've been editing. Typically, we think of asymmetry as conferring advantages on non-state actors, terrorists, and insurgents. Some say, finally, we've learned how to flip the table and gain an asymmetry on behalf of the United States. These weapons are so good. They've been so successful in this campaign that the United States has gained that advantage. At the same time, some of our most important friends, the United Nations, some of our allies, many scholars of international law, ICRC, some non-governmental organizations, deny, in the case of Pakistan, that there's any kind of armed conflict in existence there, either in relation to Al-Qaeda or the Taliban, and that anything that we do to inflict lethal force there might amount to assassination or even murder. Let me pause there.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Bill. We're going to now open up another subject on the use of force that Harold Coe spoke about in his speech, and that's the crime of aggression. In Michael Glennon's recent article, The Fog, on the Fog of Law, which talks about the crime of aggression as a blank prose crime, Michael discusses some of the risks of implementing the crime of aggression as the fourth crime in the International Criminal Court statute, along with genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes. We have here with us John Ophardt, who's written a very interesting article on the crime of aggression and cyber attacks, which looks at some of the possibilities of an individualistic basis for regulation of the use of force. John's a third-year law student here at Duke. He also holds a BA in politics from Princeton University. Prior to attending law school, John served in the United States Air Force as an electronic warfare officer assigned to the 45th Reconnaissance Squadron. He flew dozens of missions as the optics specialist on the RC-135S Cobra Ball, an aircraft designed to collect optical electronic data on ballistic missiles and their associated re-entry vehicles. Next year, John will be clerking for Judge James Deaver in the Eastern District of North Carolina. He recently published this fascinating article called Cyber Warfare and the Crime of Aggression in the Duke Law and Technology Review.
Thank you, Professor Weisbord. Thank you, Professor Silliman. It's an honor to be evidently the first student to participate on the panel at this conference. The internet and cyberspace, as we heard yesterday from the cyber panel, is a very different type of technological advancement. I consider it to be a very organic medium. It's fast, it's malleable, it's fluid. Most importantly, it's self-adapting and self-preserving. Characteristics which make it difficult to control and to predict. As described by panelists yesterday, cyberspace changes the physics of time and space. It's a very adept summary of the difficulty cyberspace poses many aspects of society. These characteristics have created three very closely related sociological pressures. They influence many aspects of our lives, economics, politics. They also have ramifications for our conceptions of the use of force. And I think that these sociological pressures, when examined in a cyber attack context, provide a very useful window into how force will be used in the future. They also suggest a need for an individualistic basis of regulation in the use of force context. These three sociological pressures are the rise of individual capabilities, which facilitates non-state actors, non-state collectives, a disaggregation of resources and power, and an erosion of the traditional conceptions of territoriality, and an erection of new territoriality conceptions. First, it's important to note that this new medium, with its strange new rules of physics, itself provides complications for our use of force analysis. As we heard yesterday, it's often difficult to determine the intent of a cyber actor in the initial stages of a cyber intrusion. The probe of defenses is the same in its initial steps as a cyber attack. An espionage activity can quickly morph and change characteristics and shape into an actual cyber aggression. It's also important to note, as Brad mentioned yesterday, that often the actor in a cyber incident is unaware of the eventual effects that the incident will cause, termed butterfly effects. This raises important questions on our ability to determine if we can't recent conflict in fall 2008 between Georgia and Russia, which may have been, there's speculation whether or not it was actually the first instance of cyber warfare coinciding with the shooting war. However, there's examples from that conflict that are very interesting to examine in this discussion. So the Georgian shooting war coincided with attacks on in cyberspace on websites and communication structures and communication networks. There were certainly overtones of state involvement. However, there were individuals who volunteered their services. We used to go down and enlist in the Army. However, these people simply turned on their computers and downloaded a program and voluntarily targeted Georgian websites. More interestingly, there was coordination of these attacks through social networking tools. Target lists were posted, current statuses of Georgian websites, stop aiming at this website, it's already been disabled, let's refocus and fire at this one. This also highlights the disaggregation of warfare in cyberspace. Every computer is now a possible weapon, and every internet connection is now a potential entrance to the battlefield. Mom calls down, it's time for dinner, and you just log off, and you're no longer on the battlefield. You can't control the use of force by limiting access to hardware. All of these components of hardware have considerably more significant legitimate uses than they do illegitimate ones, which is vastly different than in AK-47. The domination of certain protocols and software also means that all of these rifles are shooting the same ammunition. The internet's architecture and its homogeneity permits remote, largely anonymous worldwide access. An example of this is botnets. For those who aren't familiar with the term, botnets are large networks of hacked zombie machines. You can think of them as sleeper cells of cyber aggression. They're created either by loosely collected groups like the Russian Business Network, who's responsible for a lot of nefarious aspects of the internet, or highly motivated individuals. They can be created through malicious software or by exploiting existing vulnerabilities. The RBN reportedly, the Russian Business Network reportedly, will rent their machines to you for a nominal fee of 4 cents a machine. So it's capable to make a payment on the black market for $4,000, and suddenly you have 100,000 machines in a botnet where one individual can pick a target and unleash a distributed denial of service attack, which will be triggered from potentially dozens of countries, be routed through dozens more countries at a single target. So this loose collective has developed the capability, but an individual is still the one who's activating it. This is true disaggregation of power, which also shows the importance of individual action in the cybersphere. It also demonstrates erosion of traditional conceptions of territoriality. An attack in cyberspace will travel over the fastest route, not the geographically shortest route. It will look at traffic on a network and route around potential roadblocks and potential bottlenecks, which means that we can rarely predict the route in advance. It's even harder to recreate the route after it's occurred. More importantly, when examining these potentially aggressive acts, which territory are we discussing? We heard a lot yesterday about virtual worlds. Is it the geographic actual territory, or is it the virtual territory? An example of this conundrum is, again, from the Georgia-Russian conflict. At the height of the cyber attacks, Georgian websites were largely inaccessible, and so they were moved to host servers in the United States. After the move, the attacks continued. So these new cyber attacks on servers in the United States, are these attacks on Georgia, or are these attacks on the United States? Is it the territory lines on a map that matter, or is it content-based? Is it the fact that it was a Georgian website? Is it the country extension on the website, or would it be the same if it was a .com? In a different extension. So in light Assembly State Party's attempts to define a crime progression. It's a unique opportunity to expand regulation into these new realms, and also to regulate individual conduct, because individual conduct is incredibly important in the cyber context. As Brad touched on yesterday, it's important to reach through online persona, past the handles and the avatars, and usernames, and touch the individual in the real world. If we can't do that, then it's going to be difficult to regulate this type of conduct. Important to this discussion is the principle of complementarity. State parties to the Rome Statute's initial obligation will be to effectuate these changes in their own laws. This incorporation of cutting-edge limitations on aggressive behavior will commit those nation states to regulate within their own borders. Most importantly, regardless of the institutional framework we're discussing, regardless of whether or not it's the crime regression or use of force more generally, we need to consider these sociological forces. We need to find ways to adapt our framework to be relevant in the coming conference. Thank you.
Thanks so much, John. It looks like all the panelists, what we have in common now is that from the technological perspective, from the legal perspective, things are shifting. There's an attempt to shift the gaze from the state to the individual, because the individual is becoming more empowered to launch attacks, attacks tantamount to a manifest violation of the UN Charter. Is this the new direction that law and technology should be going? Any of the panelists?
I was going to ask Michael about the pertinence of Westphalia. Does the Westphalian model allow us to conduct counterterrorism operations in Pakistan?
Predator strikes in Pakistan and Afghanistan don't fall on the Castro side of the spectrum. They fall in the middle, and I would feel most uncomfortable trying to give any considered legal judgment as to the lawfulness of any strike unless I were apprised of the facts. And the facts in almost all of those instances are highly classified and relate to the number of the 15 variables that I've identified. What is the relevance, therefore, of the pertinence of Westphalia as contrasted with the United Nations Charter? The answer is that the Charter, as I suggested, provides an overly broad umbrella within which to justify strikes that probably cannot be justified when those 15 factors are considered in toto. But more important, if one takes the view, as I do, that the United Nations Charter in its use of force provisions has, as a consequence of its violation by many states, hundreds of times over a period of six decades, fallen into desuetude, that is not pertinent for assessing the legality of an assassination effort in circumstances such as those surrounding the plots against Fidel Castro. It is still unlawful, notwithstanding the status of the United Nations Charter. That's the pertinent.
Bill, what do you think? Do you think there's an armed conflict with Pakistan?
I doubt it. I think there probably is not an armed conflict with Pakistan. The laws of armed conflict have a fairly detailed body of guidelines to suggest the criteria for when fighting amounts to an armed conflict. It must be sustained. It must be at a high level, not episodic, and it's at least debatable whether that threshold has been met in Pakistan. just thinking as Michael was speaking now about Coe's speech of a few weeks ago, again, I've got the text here, and I'm reminded, you know, the title of Coe's address was the Obama Administration in International Law. And a few pages in, when he gets to the use of force, he makes a point of saying in a sentence adjacent to the one that I quoted on my slide a few minutes ago, he says, as a matter of domestic law, Congress authorized the use of all necessary and appropriate force through the AUMF in 2001. These domestic and international legal authorities continue to this day. So he's hanging his hat, as it were, on at least two spheres of authority that transcend IHL.
Well, let me just say this about that. I didn't address the issues of domestic law, but let me suggest this is also an extremely complicated area. It depends in each fact situation as to what the posture of Congress is. Now, Harold, in his talk, I think, rightly pointed out that if you're talking implicitly about applying the steel seizure analysis of Justice Jackson and Jackson's tripartite analysis, what's happening in Pakistan and Afghanistan falls within Justice Jackson's first category, the category where the president's authority is at its highest, because he's acting pursuant not only to his independent powers as commander-in-chief, but also pursuant to authority that was given him by the Congress in the so-called AUMF, which was enacted on September 14th following the 9/11 attacks, which authorizes the president to use force against any person or organization that was involved in those attacks. As a matter of domestic law, therefore, it is possible that the United States could be a law violator within the international legal system, but could be acting entirely lawfully within its domestic law. Now, I think that the AUMF, frankly, is sloppily drafted. I think it ought to be repealed and rewritten. It is shameful that the Congress reacted reflexively with what was really an unnecessary statute 2 days after the 9/11 attacks, one that has an indeterminate effect on multiple pre-existing restraints on executive power. One that arises in this category, for example, is 18 U.S.C. 242. One question that arises is whether it's possible under existing domestic law to engage in targeted killings of Americans who are located abroad. And that situation actually has arisen. Well, 18 U.S.C. 242 makes it a crime to acting under color of law as a governmental actor to deprive an inhabitant of the United States of privileges or immunities conferred upon that person by the Constitution or laws of the United States. So it is conceivable, operating on a blank slate in the absence of the AUMF, that that civil rights statute could have some application to the targeted killing of an American inhabitant, whatever that is. But the subsequent in time, AUMF raises questions about the authority of the president to use force against an American citizen in those situations. One final thought, now that we're on the subject of domestic terrorism. My own view is that the executive order 12333 is largely meaningless, simply because under the last in time doctrine that I've just referred to, any subsequent directive of the president to the intelligence community to whack somebody supersedes the prohibition in 12333. fall within that category. They are widely accepted and clearly defined limits imposed by the international legal system that are part of our law and binding on the president, because the president is bound by federal common law.
Could I add a couple of comments? I largely agree with Michael, and I share his view that the AUMF is not a useful statute at this point in time. I wonder, however, whether going on 9 years, it's also losing its legitimacy by virtue of passage of time. I also point out that we've construed it as an authorization to fight a defensive war against Al Qaeda. Targets in Pakistan include Al Qaeda, but they also include Taliban. Massoud was Taliban. The AUMF does not issue authority to target Massoud. So some, I think Mr. Coe, Abe Sofair, others along the way, State Department legal advisors, say we're fighting continuously in self-defense or against terrorism, or more narrowly put by the Obama administration, or against Al Qaeda. So that the self-defense rationale at domestic law and at international law might provide authority where the laws of armed conflict do not, where the AUMF might not reach. Some have suggested a new statute, and that might be worth taking a look at a little bit later. Thanks.
Michael, in some of your work, you've written that the law of the charter is indeterminate, and it's no longer good law. That the law is not clear, it doesn't direct behavior, it's no longer followed, and in terms of the crime of aggression, the law is too ambiguous to be used in a criminal trial. How would you distinguish between a law that's too ambiguous and a law that's determinate enough? Do the laws of espionage and treason fit your category of determinate or indeterminate? And what about the law of loitering?
Well, you've asked a number of questions, and my objection to the crime of aggression in the articles that you refer to is that it runs afoul of the principle of legality in the international legal system. My objection to, or I should say my reservations about applying the United Nations Charter as a rule of decision in fact situations of the sort that we're talking about is precisely what I said a moment ago. It's not simply that Article 2.4 and its application is too vague. Indeed, the problem with Article 51, the flip side of Article 2.4, is not that it's too vague, but that it's too determinate. And because of that determinacy, very determinacy, it's easy to see how it has been violated so many times. The high-level panel of the Secretary General, in a footnote to the report filed 4 years ago, indicated that if the charter has been violated anywhere between 200 and 680 times in its use of force prohibitions between 1945 and 1989. Now, one has to ask, what is the juridical effect of that record of massive noncompliance in a state system that is consent-based, in which it is necessary to examine all the evidence of word and deed to determine what it is, what the rule is that states actually consent to. I think, without getting into a lengthy discussion of destitute, that it is, as a matter of analytic clarity, useful to distinguish working rules from paper rules when you use terms like law, and that it is looking at all the evidence pretty clear that states don't view the United Nations Charter's prohibitions against the use of force any longer as binding. Now, that's very different from
missile from the drone. Does it matter, legally, who's pressed the button that fires the missile?
It matters. I think in the in law, the question is whether there's authority. the authority exists for the CIA to be involved in these operations by virtue of statute, National Security Act of 1947, as amended. Certainly gives them authority. It's recognized throughout the period that Michael was referring to, up to the Castro assassination. Even if some of their operations were as unlawful at the bad end of the scale as the Castro regime, was clearly understood from 47 forward that they could be involved in operations that concern the use of force. So I think by statute, so long as the president complies with procedural requirements, finding that the targeted killing program is underway, the targets are such and such a nature, and circumstances for the use of force are determined on a case-by-case basis, as Harold Coe said a few weeks ago, and I think we will report it to that. Mm-hmm.
So the CIA officer who fires the missile, is he a combatant or a civilian?
Why does it matter?
Question to John. There's an attack on a nuclear reactor in the United States. Actually, there's two attacks. There's two nuclear reactors. The first one is attacked by a missile crossing the border of the United States and striking the reactor. The second is launched by a hacker who somehow destroys the reactor, causing damage and to manifest violation of the UN Charter. Do you distinguish these two situations?
First, as a general disclaimer to alleviate some potential concern. As was mentioned yesterday, our nuclear facilities are rather robustly protected in the sense that most of them, not aware of any that are linked to the actual internet. So, close networks are perhaps the best safety against this, but perhaps the electric grid would be a good example.
Or a cipher sent by a state in order to enter the reactor site and sabotage it. That would also fit under General Assembly Resolution 3314.
Could you pull your mic?
Okay, apology. to those watching online. So perhaps the power grid would be a good example, or possibly rerouting of trains would also be another potential catastrophic use of cyberspace to have access to the mass transit authorities' control systems in New York City and redirect subways to cause loss of life. Probably would amount to a manifest violation of the UN Charter. To distinguish that between a missile attack on, or some type of explosive attack in the New York subway. I think that to make this the distinction between these levels, we need some type of movement of our paradigm shift and some type of framework movement, which some have suggested is going to be by analogy. That we're resultant, we're results based. There's loss of life, therefore this is the equivalent of an attack that occurred in the kinetic realm. That's a difficult framework to use if you're trying to determine steps you can take in a defensive capacity. If we're trying to provide guidance for individuals making decisions when the events
the other panelists think that it would be wise to include cyber attacks under the current framework on use of force?
Well, I can answer that quickly. I don't think there is any current framework on the use of force, so the question is nonsensical.
Okay, so let's follow up on that then. My earlier question about distinguishing when a law is determinate and when a law is indeterminate has come up a few times in the discussion this morning. Michael, could you clarify for us how you would make this distinction?
How I distinguish between determinacy and indeterminacy? What's vague and what's not vague? Is that your question?
Exactly, yeah.
Well, I can't improve upon the test promulgated by the United States Supreme Court in the void for vagueness doctrine, which is part of due process that is applied as part of our constitutional jurisprudence in criminal cases, particularly First Amendment cases. The test is whether a person of common intelligence must guess whether the conduct in question is criminal at the time it is engaged in. If a person of common intelligence does not understand and cannot understand by reading the law that the statute in question makes that individual's conduct criminal before it is engaged in, that statute is deemed void for vagueness because it does not provide the requisite notice required by due process. As I said, I think that's a very reasonable interpretation of the command of the due process clause, and that's how I would distinguish determinacy from indeterminacy for purposes of individual criminal liability. And the central problem with the crime of aggression, as it has been promulgated, we're going to get into this now, as it's been proposed to be defined by the special working group and is apparently about to be included in the statute, the Rome statute that sets up the International Criminal Court. The central problem is it doesn't meet that test. It does not meet that test. There's no question that it fails that standard. We can talk about the reasons for that. I don't want to dominate the discussion here, but the principle of legality in international law is a core human rights law. It is indeed said by some people to be so fundamental that it's jus cogens. And it's incorporated, as a matter of fact, in the statute, the Rome statute itself. And the statute provides that the International Criminal Court will act in accordance with internationally recognized human rights. This is as fundamental an internationally recognized human right as you could get. So that when the proposed definition would, as a matter of individual criminal liability, expose a person to a criminal penalty for a manifest violation of the United Nations Charter, I don't know what that is, and it seems to me that's a blatant violation of the principle of legality.
But wouldn't the common intelligence test be void for vagueness itself?
I don't think so.
No, I see your argument. I know there's a whole jurisprudence on this already existing. Courts have judged in this. I'm just putting the question out there because it's one of the most important critiques of the crime of aggression that has come out to date.
No.
Yes, please, John.
You
about indeterminacy here, so let's expand the discussion of indeterminacy to look at the indeterminacy of the battlefield, of the territorial limits of the battlefield, which pertains to targeted assassination and the drone strikes in a variety of ways, not the least of which is that if the United States is responding in self-defense to the attacks of 9/11, we need to figure out where are the limits of their right to engage in self-defense. Do any of the panelists have a position on this?
Well, I think one of the key questions in Pakistan is alluded to by Michael in his opening remarks in his list of considerations, sovereign consent. The existence or non-existence of consent in Pakistan is not easy to discern. At least formally, pretty clear that there was no consent earlier, but in the last year, and particularly in recent months, it appears as though some form of consent may have emerged. It's hard to know what form you would expect that to take inside of Pakistan. If you look carefully at Harold Coe's remarks from a few weeks ago, again, he talked about that consent was an important consideration, but he didn't say that it was essential. And some, including Phil Alston, an NYU law professor who's a special rapporteur to the UN on human rights and wrote about the drone strikes before. Highly critical of the lack of consent formally given by Pakistan and the U.S. and the use of the strikes in that environment. Alston was asked to comment after Harold's speech of a few weeks ago, and he said he remained troubled because Mr. Coe did not say that the consent was a necessary precondition to the use of that. And like the charter and practice, I wonder if there's a developing that will chip away at the necessity of a sovereign sign-off.
Michael, let me just say that this bill raises an extremely interesting question, an important point. And sometimes what you see is not what you get when you're talking about state consent to these kinds of activities, as many of you practice in this area. Operating in this area, you know. Sometimes states say something publicly that is not exactly the same that they say privately. Sometimes states tell you ahead of time that they're going to object to something if it ever becomes public, but sub silentio give their consent. There was a big brouhaha, has been a big over the last few years about an CIA operation in Italy that went awry through disastrously bad tradecraft, in which a number of CIA people have been indicted for kidnapping some fellow convicted in absentia of kidnapping a fellow in Italy. The question, of course, is whether the Italian government consented. Now, of course, for public purposes, they say, of course, we didn't consent. But, you know, sometimes in this sort of situation, what happens is the government in question says, look, it's okay if you proceed to do this. With the understanding that if it ever becomes public, we are going to complain to high heavens about it. We never consented to this, and we're going to say that if you are sloppy about how you do this. So you can't always determine whether consent was given by reading the New York Times. In fact, sometimes the public statements of states are, I hate to say it, misleading.
There's a lot of fog surrounding both war and law, as you pointed out, Michael. Does it make sense to have a process, either legal or political, that reveals more of the evidentiary aspects of a conflict, such as the conflict between Russia and Georgia? Is it going to increase international security to reveal who struck first to the public? Or should these decisions be left to the backroom politics of the Security Council or some other body?
Well, I'm in favor of transparency, sure, why not? If anything, the one of the many problems with the UN Security Council is precisely, as Noah suggests, these kinds of decisions often are made in backrooms, and you don't know who really is vetoing what. The process is anything but transparent. One really can't come to a judgment, therefore, who the bootleggers are or whether the process is working well.
If we're going to regulate or have some sort of control over the principal basis of an assassination, what is the appropriate way to regulate that so that it doesn't go awry?
Well, one approach was suggested a few years ago by Phil Hyman in Japan, proposed model statute they would have preferred that Congress enact that would authorize targeted killing in, quote, a zone of active combat or subject to statutory standards outside a zone of active combat, quote, where necessary to prevent a greater reasonably imminent harm or in defense against a reasonably imminent threat to the life of one or more persons. So there's a standard. It does supply more than we have now. And as I recall, their model would further incorporate existing IHL rules such as distinction and proportionality. They do deal with the U.S. person question that Michael alluded to earlier. There's the cleric now in Walkie, the guy who's in Yemen. Any target the U.S. person, Michael raises the U.S. code prohibition. And I think they would put a direct prohibition on targeting Walkie as well.
I suggest now that we open up the discussion to the audience so that we can continue this. Yeah, Scott.
First of all, let me, Scott Sullivan, Duke University, let me commend the panel for his superb commentary. Bill, I've got to press you on a question, and I invite Michael to join. Noah asked you if a CIA officer was the trigger puller, would it make a difference? And you said no. My understanding is that one to lawfully kill must have the combatant's privilege. Are you suggesting that CIA or Mossad in dealing with Dubai has the combatant's privilege?
I'm not suggesting that. I think that that's a good question. I think at IHL, whether the CIA operative could take on the cloak of a combatant and have a combatant's privilege, I think under existing IHL, he could not. And again, we would simply, in the United States, fall back on domestic law to provide authority for the operation, even if it's not authorized under IHL, or it might sort of for even if it's with some strand of international law.
I see there's a question from Vijay, who's the author of a recent report by the Council on Foreign Relations on the crime of aggression. Please, Vijay.
Thanks, Noah, and thanks to the panelists. This was a great presentation. I'm actually going to ask the question not about aggression, but I want to follow up with Bill about your comment about Pakistan. So two things you said kind of surprised me about Pakistan. The first was you said that you didn't think there was a war going on in Pakistan. And I'm wondering if by that you meant there's not a war going on between the U.S. and the Pakistani government, which I think that's certainly the case, there's not a war going on there, or whether you were making the more far-reaching assertion that there's not a war going on with Al-Qaeda there, which I think is problematic, especially given the fact that the very elements that planned the 9/11 attacks have moved from Afghanistan to, at least according to news reports, to the tribal regions of Pakistan. So it seems as though if we're in a war with Al-Qaeda anywhere, it would be in the mountains of Pakistan and Afghanistan as a combined area. And then the second point you made that I found surprising had to do with the consent point. And I know that Harold's speech sort of just riffed off what we had worked with in the State Department Legal Advisor's Office during the Bush administration, which was this unable or unwilling concept that certainly consent, state consent's important, but at the point at which states are unable or unwilling to control threats that are emanating from their territory, well then states acquire the right to be able to use force to quell those threats. And so I think Michael's right. I think it's very unclear what, I mean, suggestions are that Pakistan's actually consented to the operation of the U.S. drones there, but even if they hadn't, it's very obvious that the Pakistani government lacks the ability to do anything with respect to that threat, and therefore it would seem the U.S. or NATO, ISAF, is empowered to take action against the gathering threat in Pakistani territory.
Right. Those are great questions. What I intended to say initially, if I misspoke, I'm sorry, is that there may be no armed conflict in Pakistan. To IHL, I do believe the United States is fighting the defense of the war in the Pakistan mountains against Al-Qaeda and against certain elements of the Taliban. Sean Murphy's written a very good paper that picks apart the different strands of combatancy, insurgency, and terrorism in Pakistan. There are at least four different groups that can be aligned against the United States in different ways, and are fighting with them would be pursuant to different authorities. We are fighting in the defense of war there. With respect to consent, I agree. I think at least since the mid-80s, so fair opinions, I think we maintained the right to go after a state, to go after insurgents or terrorists in a state that's not capable of expelling them or combating them themselves. And I think there's good authority now over more than 20 years' time for that. I think the code speech is another data point. Customary thread developing law in that area. It does create problems, as Mike has said, when consent is a game that you can't quite judge transparently for purposes of international relations. Are there boundaries? Do we do the same thing in Yemen, whether we're pursuing a walkie, the American, or someone else? Ophardt was the first prominent drone strike in 2002, was the guy. Six people in a car, the next moment they were dust. That was Yemen. The same rules apply there that we have some kind of sub silencio consent from the Yemen government. Somalia, we could go into places that are even more complicated.
I think the last two questions raise a point that we now need to focus on. Issue that was addressed in yesterday's panel by Michael Luning. The last two questions suggest that we need somehow to make a judgment as to whether a single factor can be viewed as dispositive for purposes of triggering the application of the law of armed conflict, international humanitarian law. Michael suggested, and I completely agree with this, that we're in the slow process of recognizing that neither the traditional law enforcement model nor the traditional war model applies to this twilight zone within which the war against terror is being fought. It doesn't make sense to me to cause the whole legal analysis to turn upon whether the guy whose finger is on the button gets his paycheck from the CIA or the Pentagon. It doesn't make sense to me to make the whole analysis turn upon whether a technical state of war exists between Lebanon and Israel. It seems to me we need to get beyond reference to classic set piece wars of the sort that were fought in the 1940s and in World War One, and classic battlefield wars between standing armies. And that's just not the kind of set of fact situations that we're dealing with here today. And the traditional categories just don't work. They were devised for facts that are very different from those that we're confronting in this world. So that's why I suggest that not one of these factors ought to be viewed necessarily as dispositive. It's more of a multi-factor balancing test that we're moving towards in this greater than between the two poles.
And Mike, who do you think, who would you prefer to do this test?
My preferences are irrelevant. In the world in which we live, the rules are made by states. It is a system that is governed by rules to which states consent. Several of us were having a conversation over breakfast this morning as to whether it might be possible to get state consent, for example, on rules applicable to cyber warfare. But these are not rules that can be dreamed up by law professors, as so much of the literature in this realm is, frankly. We've got to get beyond the kind of wishful thinking and recognize that the real rules in the real world are not the rules that we law professors would prefer. They're rules that are made by states in the cauldron of practice, and that the rules that work in many, many cases are work because of a pragmatic reciprocity of advantage. And it's the task of lawyers to try to find those commonalities to get states together, as President Obama did last week with respect to securing nuclear materials, try to get states together to continually try to identify those commonalities. But ultimately, it's states that have to consent to these rules, not law professors.
There's a question from the gentleman in front.
Hi, Peter Raven Hanson, George Washington University. I have a question about the Peter Raven Hanson, George Washington, mostly. It's been said that the tightening of military detention laws have led to more target killings, not because of some top-down order, but because it's a practical matter. Soldiers in the field might figure we better kill because it's more complicated to capture. It's also been argued that if we didn't permit targeted killings, more Taliban foot soldiers would ultimately die in alternative armed conflicts. And I wonder if there's any truth to these two claims. And in connection with that, I thought the reason to doubt them is that, contrary to what Bill said, my impression is that the targeting decisions are actually rather closely controlled, and that there are target lists and JAG officers present, and proportionality has been a major element in the determination. And if that's true, then my first hypothesis would probably be false, given the presence of JAG people in the targeting. So I wonder if the panel would comment on that.
I think your first hypothesis is false for the reason you just mentioned. I do think that the operational rules are far more advanced and sophisticated than either domestic law or international law would require, and perhaps that either domestic law or international law contain. That is, operations and policy may go well beyond the law and may not have become part of the law. One idea that I've seen bandied about is that the law is becoming irrelevant, or is at risk of becoming irrelevant in this area. In a counterinsurgency environment, of course, the war now, the purpose is to persuade. This is the whole hearts and minds thing. So
see Mark Weisbord in the back. He's an expert on the use of force.
Thank you, Noah. Not really. I'm Mark Weisbord from UNC Law School. First, a comment for Mr. Ophardt and a question for Professor Glennon. Mr. Ophardt, with respect to your observation regarding the Supreme Court's void for vagueness doctrine and the irrelevance of violations to applying that doctrine, I would point out that the Supreme Court's dealing with the domestic legal system. When we're talking about international law, we're talking about a system based on the practice of the entities which are themselves subject to the legal system. In that context, violations of a rule change the rule, which of course simply isn't true in a domestic legal system. And if the rule is being changed, then figuring out its content isn't easy. Professor Glennon, I'd like to push you a little bit on your observations regarding the opinion of juris element of customary law. Of course, I may have misunderstood you, but I thought I understood you to say that if the state engages in behavior by reason of some notion of advantage or avoidance of disadvantage, it can't be said to be acting because it sees itself as bound by a legal obligation. But one of the things I've often puzzled over is just exactly what it means to say that. That is, certainly, I'm bound by a legal obligation not to speed when I'm on the interstate. And the reason I don't speed is partly because I'm not a good enough driver to drive fast, but also because I don't want to get stopped by the highway patrol. Now, there is certainly no existential notion that it is a minimum and safe speed. I want to avoid a bad consequence. Why is that not acting from a sense of legal obligation? Thank you.
Yes. You raise a profound question. No one has thought more comprehensively and deeply about these issues concerning specifically the destitute of the use of force rules than Mark Weisbord. I've been informed and educated by his writings over the years. Raises one of the central conceptual problems concerning customary international law that traces in particular to an observation of the International Court in the North Sea Continental Shelf cases, in which the court suggested that there is indeed a third element, just as I described in my remarks, beyond simply practice and opinio iuris, the notion that the practice is pursued from a sense of legal obligation. But the suggestion in North Sea Continental Shelf cases was that there must be a causal relationship between the two. Now, Judge Locks, in a separate opinion, challenged the majority in that case by suggesting that the majority, in effect, set the bar way too high, and that one could never find the existence of a customary norm if the causation element, in effect a kind of but-for causation, were applied in situations such as that fact situation. And to give you a practical example of what Mark is talking about, and it's a common one, Boston City Council required everybody to wear an overcoat when the temperature went below 32 degrees. One would say that, hey, compliance with the law is very high. And the court, in order to distinguish compliance with the law from practice that represents convenience or courtesy or simple self-interest, has therefore insisted upon this causation test. You don't really know simply looking
problem that Mark raises, and that is, as I said in my remarks, one of the reasons that I think it's dangerous to get sidetracked in this metaphysical discussion of customary international law in trying to decide whether assassination is lawful. Is it caused by the perception of a rule and a desire to comply with the rule that traces back to 1648? Or is it caused by fear of retaliation? You know, the truth is that our social scientific techniques just are not yet sophisticated enough to answer that question. It's impossible to engage in regression analysis or time difference in studies, any of these more recent sophisticated techniques of the sort that Una Hathaway does, for example, in this article in the Human Rights Conventions to identify the purported cause of the behavior question. We just can't get into the heads of decision makers. John referred to the butterfly effect. It is to complicate things further, often the case that it is some inconsequential, unnoticed factor, some trivial variable that the most fastidious social science techniques would never uncover, that ultimately causes state behavior. So I don't have any good answer for Mark's question, except to suggest that that's one of the reasons that I avoid customary international law in my analysis, and I don't want anybody to think that because of these very profound empirical difficulties, states can get off the hook and claim that they're free because it's impossible to establish a customary norm that indicates that assassination is prohibited. It's prohibited because it's incompatible with the very notion of sovereignty. Thank you.
There's a question way in the back, please, if you can introduce yourself as well.
Thanks, I'm Gansford in Greensboro. Professor Banks, I was interested in the facet of Professor Sullivan's question going back to the distinction between combatants and civilians. A reciprocity question, really. If there's an armed conflict, and if that CIA operative has the authority under international law, the Geneva Convention, to push that button to kill somebody, a Pakistani citizen in Pakistan, does Pakistan have the right to follow him home to Manassas and drop a missile on his head that night? And also, again with reciprocity, I personally can't think of a situation in which if the Chinese started dropping missiles on Hoovers in America, or if the Israelis or anyone else started doing this, that we tolerate everything. Where does that all fit in? Where do we go from here?
The easy answer is I don't know. Let me try a little bit more than that. The premise, I think, that makes your question difficult is the assumption that there's an armed conflict. Absent an armed conflict, indeed, the ICRC and lots of other very respected lawyers and others around the world believe that there are only two paradigms. There are armed conflict and law enforcement. And if we're not in a state of armed conflict, the only way to deal with the worst of the worst is to effectuate an arrest and judicial trial and conviction. And for an armed conflict, then you have the principles distinction, reciprocity, proportionality. I think if we're in an armed conflict and the CIA is pulling the trigger for us, then yes, principle of reciprocity makes them vulnerable as would be someone else. And I think that part of the dynamic in the Coe speech and principles from Afghanistan and Pakistan as part of the law of the United States about how targeting is done and implement exercises. These may be operational principles, ROE, for a given mission or a set of missions that may not find their way into legal requirements. I think the problem of reciprocity is a serious one, though, for civilians and others who may be participating in these operations. One question is, what's the alternative? It may be that targeted killing in some of these environments is the least bad option. If we're unwilling to commit more ground assets in the environment where these people are, and we've so far been unwilling to do that, although we seem to be getting better intelligence somehow, partly from the ground, then I don't know what the alternative is, so this may be the least bad alternative.
One last question before we wrap up, from the gentleman in the front.
Steve.
Steve, could you please introduce yourself for the video?
Steve Dykus from Omaha School. I want to ask about one element of indeterminacy that I don't think has been addressed directly here. Pretty much all discussion has been based on the premise that we know who we're shooting at, and we know that the target is one of the worst of the worst, as Bill suggested a moment ago. What obligation, if any, do you think the state has to be certain about the identity and the guilt or threat from the target, and what obligation, whatever Article 51 requires, to explain to the world why it chose the particular target it did?
I just opened by saying I think that the obligation is affirmative and strong. Reading about the Afghanistan operations and counterinsurgency, there is an operational acronym now, PID, positive identification, and there's a wallet card criteria that operators in combat, operators in the field, military officers, their personnel should be utilizing in making an identification in every confrontation where there's use of lethal force. I think it's taken very seriously. That's part of General Crystal's program. It's coined, it's out there everywhere. I don't know that it has legal standing.
Well, my quick answer is I give the questions of whether there is an obligation in international law to reveal classified intelligence indicating why a certain target was selected. I know of no obligation in international law that requires it.
Please join me in thanking the panelists for this.
Strikes me as interesting that as with the cyber panel yesterday and this panel this morning, we brought together the best and the brightest we can assemble here, and the conclusion seems to be that the existing legal regime is ill-equipped to deal with the factual situations. And I'm struck by Bill's last comment. You know, we don't know where we go from here, but we've got to go somewhere. We're going to take a 15-minute break. For those of you who would still like to sign up for joining us at lunch to hear Bob Litt speak, Stephanie still has some tickets available if you'd like to. I noticed they have refreshed the morning break snacks for all of you who are still hungry. And otherwise, we'll see you in 15 minutes for Professor Helfer's panel. Thank you.
I found that more depressing than the cyber one. Yes.
Oh,
because the cyber ones, the cyber ones are a failure of technology. It's a failure of law. I feel more personally involved here.
Actually,
I drive past Langley regularly. One of our board members was just out of us. And you know, I drive by and I'm sort of thinking, am I live enough to get collateral damage from some Pakistani bomb that's in here walks down that driveway because they're. Here's the question I have. What if China found that there was some...